Beyond, and hello and welcome once again to IGN's weekly PlayStation show. I'm your host, Max Scoville, and joining me today are Jada Griffin, Brian Altano, and Akeem Lawanson. Hello, everybody.
Thanks. Hello.
Yo.
You showed up. You're cool.
Yeah, I did.
The other two of you, you're on thin ice calling in.
How dare you?
Far away.
How dare you both? Akeem, you know you need to be on the bus on Monday evening to get to the studio for us on time.
Monday evening.
I'm at the same place I've always been I've been on this show. How
I'm
dare
just
you?
Giving you
yeah,
guys
it's
a
called
hard
thin
time.
Ice.
I'm just razzing you, but you are on thin ice, Akeem, so watch it, buddy. Anyway.
How do we make it thicker? Tell me now.
I just throw another layer of water down.
Less fire, more
gotcha.
Cold. Anyway.
We're doing a board game episode. Thin Ice was a good game. That was a good game.
Was that the paper towel one where you get the paper towel wet and the marbles?
It's so cheap. You just get wet paper towels and you put balls on them until they collapse. That's it.
This is a show about the Sony PlayStation game console and video game ecosystem. We have all sorts of important business news to discuss, but also some silly stuff like Spider-Man shoes and Foamstars. But we should probably address the wonderful, big, huge, loud blog post that went up immediately after we recorded last week, which is the news that Jim Ryan is retiring, the head of Sony Interactive Entertainment, who has been with the company since 1994. He could have gone for a full 30 years, but he's doing it a little bit short, he's going to dip out in March 2024, which is, I think he started shortly before the release of the original PlayStation way back in 94.
Can't wear out your welcome.
He didn't get the platinum
PlayStation, so he'll forever have that shame hanging over his head.
Fake gamer, that's what we call him.
Real businessman, fake gamer. I think there's some of those out there. But Sony's chief operating officer Hiroki Totoki will be taking over as interim CEO. Ryan has like an interesting legacy because he's clearly been there for a while. And it's not like he is the guy who goes up to the dry erase board and draws the next PlayStation. And then everyone's like, all right, we'll make that. Like, it's a massive corporation that has all sorts of moving parts, all sorts of people making business decisions. It's publicly traded. So there's, of course, a room full of just big sort of monolithic faces that just have voices like an Evangelion, and they're just like trade that to buy, sell, low, high, whatever. I don't know how business works. Anyway, so Jim Ryan has sort of, I think he's got people are relieved to hear he's leaving, which
yeah.
is, I get it. You know, he's simultaneously can kind of take credit for the PS5 being a massive, massive success as a console, but also he put his foot in his mouth a couple times, you know?
Oh, a bunch of times. Yeah.
Yeah. How do we all feel about this?
Go for it, Jada.
I mean, it's just, I don't know. For me, it's not that big of a thing for me. Like, I see a lot of the sentiment online that people are excited that he's leaving. It is what it is. He did some good things. He did some bad things. I think that's all business people in general. Not everybody's going to be a Reggie Fils-Aimé. You know what I mean? Not everybody can be that when it comes to.
He invented the 3DS. Did you know that?
He did.
He made it with his bare hands.
Bare hands.
His enormous hands.
He walked into a production meeting at Nintendo, said, my body is ready. And then he created the 3DS out of nothing.
Kick ass and make 3DSs.
Yeah. But
I don't like the idea of Reggie producing the 3DS from his body. Can we shut that down right now?
Let's not run with that rumor, please not.
Yeah. Heard it here first on IGN's number one PlayStation show, the history of
that
the
is not how consoles are made. No. They are not produced by bodies.
It's technically a handheld, not a console. But anyway, go on.
Okay, but people don't lay them like eggs.
I was thinking more of just like creating matter in his hand, but that's fine. You guys went further. You guys went making it out
of
the
box. So you're saying he laid the egg in his hand?
Okay, all right. So, so basically Jim Ryan, he's a
businessman.
That's
how he got that nickname in high school. Egg hands.
So the PlayStation 5 has been real successful as a console, doing real great over there. It sold, 40 million units or something?
Oh, yeah.
That's not something that, Jim Ryan can take full credit for, because it was kind of a thing that was in motion beforehand. And I think the first four PlayStations before it kind of helped, generate some of that goodwill. Yeah. He can also, if he can take credit for that, he could also be blamed for stuff like the PSVR 2, which hasn't had the most exactly, I guess, numbers-wise, doing okay, but also...
It's selling well. There's a lot of good games out for the PSVR 2, not like first party Sony stuff that we've been all asking for and like wanting updates on. But there is a good healthy library. There's a bunch of stuff that just dropped recently, so a lot of people are coming
That's
very
true.
Soon.
There has been a ton of PSVR 2 game and got that got announced over on the blog. It'd be nice to have like a, you know, a PlayStation state of play about that, or, you know, just a little update for people who are into that thing. It just feels like it's kind of, they've been kind of radio silent about the PSVR 2. Meanwhile, there's also the PlayStation Portal, formerly known as the Project Q, which is up for pre-order now.
Isn't it out like next month, like November,
out,
right?
It's out November 15th. Yeah. So that's a thing. We've talked about that a bit.
It's worth pointing out that Jim Ryan said that like one of the reasons he's not working there anymore is because like he didn't want to travel, like the traveling got too much. And this is all the more reason that PlayStation needs an actual dedicated handheld gaming device and not this cloud bullshit. If they had made a Vita 2, I think Jim Ryan would still be at the company.
He can't play his games while he's flying to Japan constantly.
Good job, PlayStation. It costs you a president, and I hope you're happy.
I think that's the reason why it was created, though, because he doesn't like to travel, so he just wants to be at home with the PlayStation Portal.
Good job, PlayStation. You cost us a handheld.
We're now live to footage of the PlayStation Portal being picked up. That's it. You know, it's, I don't know. Definitely a weird legacy. You know, I think a lot of people kind of look at Jim Ryan, and he's always been like very much businessman. Whereas you look at, you know, like Shuhei or Sean Layden, and there's a certain kind of like, you know, they seem very like amiable. They're you know, approachable. Yeah. Meanwhile, like Jim Ryan, you know, one of the things that made everyone mad is that when, you know, Roe versus Wade was about to get overturned, he sent out an email where it's like, well, everybody disagrees sometime. Anyway, it was my cat's birthday recently. Yeah. And people were like, what are you doing? What's going on over there?
Well, I think it's also
nothing.
Like
what he was doing.
We have Sony, and I think honestly a lot of these companies, although I think like, you know, Xbox and Nintendo still keep the lights on a little bit. They've moved away from like the showcase or the stage show that is the conference that is led by a company figurehead, CEO, president guy. And in moving away from that, at the exact same time, they transitioned over to Jim Ryan. Like those two eras almost overlap entirely. And so you have like this lack of forward facing personality. Right now we have, you know, showcases and state of plays that are largely guided by a disembodied voice. It's like, cool, everyone's having a great time. Coming up next, it's about to get foamy. And then they show Foamstars gameplay. Or like, coming up next, here comes 17 minutes of Suicide Squad. The gang is back to get into more goofy antics. And like, that's fine. You know, that's what Maria Menounos does at work. But like, I think what they're looking for here is, what we're looking for here is like somebody that can like be forward facing. But at the same time, it's like, I don't know, billionaire CEOs aren't really your friends either. So,
yeah,
you know, it's fine. Like, I think what most PlayStation fans will look at in terms of the Jim Ryan era is that it's, you know, while the PS5 is great, and there's a bunch of great games out there and coming, his era of like sort of like leadership is not necessarily people's favorites. Although it's worth pointing out that there are a lot of people who have worked internally at Sony, both past and present, that had almost nothing but good things to say about him on social media. So like guys like John Drake, who were there for a long time, Sean Layden, who we were just shouting out, who's been like kind of like very candid on Twitter recently. They worked with him for a long time and really liked, you know, where he was and what he was doing. So I think it's worth shouting out that like he definitely brought a lot to the company for a long time. But for what the public perceived during his era was like not really great. I wasn't really wild about his bedside manner.
Like he's not, you know, kill the messenger, that kind of thing. And it's like he's not like this, you know, all-powerful king of PlayStation who comes out and goes, do this, do that, PlayStation. Yeah. Like it's a lot of decisions that were, you know, I don't know if they're above his pay grade, but they're just being made in other
companies. Yeah, it's not, he doesn't have unilateral rule over what was decided to do and stuff like that. He may make suggestions and, you know, he may be the person who's like enforcing it or being like, hey, this is what we're focusing on after talking to all the other stakeholders. But yeah, like, I don't know. I think his tenure was fine. I don't think
it's gotta suck to retire after like 30 years with a company and just be like a bunch of gamers being like, good riddance, get out of here.
He's like, I did so much for you. Don't know what I got for you in these PlayStation games.
I don't know. That said, one thing I do want to talk about is the other thing that's going on right now with PlayStation was during the Jim Ryan era is the big push into live service games, which we've talked about this a bit. At one point, I think we heard, you know, PlayStation had, what, 9 live service games?
12, I think 12 is.
Something, a bunch of them, you know?
Yeah.
The number jumps around. It was like George Lucas's original Star Wars planned movies. But much like that, you know, some of them have seen the light of day. Some of them haven't. We found out today Naughty Dog has apparently laid off some contractors who were working on The Last of Us multiplayer game, which is a huge bummer. That sucks. That especially sucks for, you know, people who need jobs, which, you know, that would be nice if they were able to have things to do that kept them paid and fed and all that. But yeah, it also sucks on a much more sort of relevant to our audience interest level that this doesn't bode well for what that game has going on for it. And we really haven't had much in the way of updates. We've gotten two JPEGs of concept art. I mean, they might be PNGs. I don't know. Two images, of two static images that aren't even screenshots, concept art.
Yeah.
And I think the rest of the updates we've gotten have been either bad news, like in this case, or they've been just sort of, hey, hold on, we're working on it. Or, hey, we're going back to the drawing board. Like, the last thing we got before this was in May, which was, we're going to give it more time. Our team will continue to work on the project as well as our other games in development, including a brand new single-player experience. We'll look forward to sharing more soon, which is sort of a weird way to be like, hey, the multiplayer thing's going to be great. Hey, everybody, we're working on a single-player game, though. Isn't that cool? And it, you know, really, that's kind of it. This is not, like, Naughty Dog's strong suit is single-player games. And
yeah.
I don't know. I wonder, you know, supposedly this whole project is on ice, whatever that means. But
yeah, it's
like me on thin ice.
You're on thin ice. That's right.
Yeah.
But I mean, are we? I'm not particularly bothered by this. I don't think that it's Naughty Dog, you know, playing to their strengths. I'm willing to give it, you know, the benefit of the doubt that there's a cool idea in there. But, you know, for anybody expecting Last of Us Factions 2, that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
And what people want for multiplayer games has obviously shifted a whole lot.
And it's going to constantly change. It's constantly changing. And by the time this releases, chances are, by the time it releases, that is also going to have changed again. Like, it's the crazy thing about game development is you're trying to hit a moving target that you can't really 100% predict what it's going to be in the 2 to 3 years when you have a solid idea starting to build out and finalize. You don't know what it's going to look like in the last couple of years of development. The landscape changes so drastically.
Or three to 7 years. Right?
Well, I mean, I was talking like once the idea is like finalized, you know, just like once we've like, okay, we know what we're doing. We know we have the team in place. Now we've got it like, you know, and again, it could be, you know, 3 to 7 years. Yeah. Game development takes a long time. It's really a hard target to hit.
So for this, I mean, to play sort of devil's advocate here, or whatever, you know, Fortnite was in development for what, 6 years post announcement. We got a trailer in 2011, and then it didn't actually drop until 2017. And initially, nobody really cared.
Like, yeah.
It was a tower defense, Minecraft zombie type thing. Yep. And then 20 minutes later, they tacked on Battle Royale, and it became the biggest thing ever. And that goes to show you sort of how that, you know, how much of a gamble, like, trying to approach that live service model is, but also that there is sort of there are second chances, you know?
Yeah, there's a way to make it work.
Yeah, you look at Final Fantasy 14, which they had to nuke it from orbit, but then they, you know, fixed it.
Literally.
Yeah.
And then Epic laid off, what, 16% of their staff the other day?
Yeah, I think it was like 870 people or not recently, so, and then they raised the price of V-Bucks.
So that's like, and that was after like several of the highest ranking people there got golden parachutes out and were like, it's been a long time with this company. I'm very proud of my work. Goodbye. And 3 weeks later, the, you know, ish hit the fan. And so like, I don't necessarily like, this is, you know, obviously this is part of a bigger conversation, right? This is part of like a thing that's a trend we've seen happening all year specifically. But to speak on what Jada was talking about, I completely agree. I think it's like, it's really, really difficult to simultaneously chase a trend and deal with the growing logistics of a dev cycle that costs hundreds of millions of dollars and takes half a decade or more. Because by the time you land on something that is totally working and is functional, you've had A, turnover within your studio, B, the audience has moved on completely from what that concept might be, and see, your IP might not even be as valuable as it was. And that's what's interesting about this. I was thinking about this morning. This is Naughty Dog laying off a not insignificant section of their workforce, QA, right? QA is quality assurance. And
it's a very important part of the workforce. Very important.
Very important part. It's how, like, when you play a game that isn't buggy and it's polished and you're happy with it and it isn't getting memed to death because, like, the character's eyeballs are shooting out of their head like that Awuga wolf or whatever, then it means that the QA department did their job. And QA is historically like underpaid, overworked. That was where a lot of the crunch, underappreciated. It's where a lot of the crunch stories were coming out of Naughty Dog a couple years ago was QA. But when you don't have like a product to assure the quality of, then you don't need a QA department. You can put them on retainer, which is why a lot of these people are on contract, because they're not necessarily working on that, you know, kind of 24/7, which means that like they don't have a game to work on right now, which means that like Last of Us 3, they said, is still a ways off. There was that like kind of rumored Neil Druckmann sci-fi, you know, new IP story. That's probably still a ways off. And then this multiplayer game is now on ice, which means that like when it comes back up for air, who knows where the games as a service market will be, right?
Yeah.
Because right now they're probably still like, well, when we started working on this game, Fortnite, PUBG, Apex, Call of Duty, those were the big ones, right? Mm-hmm. But if this game comes out in 2 or 3 years, like what's going to be dominating? Foamstars, obviously, number one game
100%
in all of gaming.
Not even a game as a service, just dominating in general.
Just dominating, yeah. Just foaming it up everywhere you look. And so like I think it's like really interesting because it's like these are completely at odds concepts. It's going to take forever until somebody figures out the right way to do it. And it just feels like gambling, because for every one of these games that comes out, there's a bunch that don't or a bunch that launch and tank. Like we just covered the story the other day about Sega shutting down Hyenas, which was like a multiplayer game that was at Gamescom. It was playable, and now it's gone. Mm-hmm. And so like what I think is interesting is like this is the studio that had the biggest, I think the biggest TV show of the year.
Mm-hmm. One of them.
But what did that actually mean? Like what did that translate to? The Last of Us was one of the biggest shows of the year, hit show on HBO. Did that mean that that was mostly gamers who already knew that world playing it? Did it mean that it was us plus people who have never played those games watching it? I think. But of those people, how many of them were like, oh, this is awesome, I'm going to turn around, buy a PS5 and drop $70 on playing a video game version of this show I already watched? Like, yeah. That's what I wonder. Because I know that, like, The Last of Us sold really well. The Last of Us 2 sold not as well. But, like, what we had kind of heard was that, like, it didn't, like, it sold 10 million units, I think, or more. But I don't know if that was enough to justify, like, the X amount of years it was in development or to sustain their studio until the next project. So, it's like a bunch of shit that's just completely at odds. You have a hit TV show that isn't translating to massive game sales. You have a massive IP that isn't translating to a multiplayer game working, that isn't translating to a games as a service model that is a moving target, all while rising costs happen and you're laying off staff. So like, same story we've heard 15 times this year, 100 times this year in the industry, is that like none of this is working well together. But if it all usually funnels back up to like 2 or 3 people at the top just making a shit ton of money.
Yep.
So I don't know, not to get negative about it, but like that's it. If you lay all the problems out on the table, that's kind of what it looks like right now, right?
Yeah, no, I mean, games as a service is tricky. To put it as nicely as possible, it is a tricky business model to get into. And
it's gambling.
And it's 100% gambling. I was about to say, it's a gamble. You never know if it's going to pay off. You don't know how the community is going to receive it. You don't know if this one weird frog character you put in is just going to like bring in 2 billion players because like, oh my God, I need to play as this frog character.
Turtle,
you don't know.
Right?
Yeah. Totally. Like, you don't know, like, how that's going to work out. I don't know if that many people went to play Star Wars because of the frog character, but it's just kind of like, you know, it's silly things like that that sometimes get mass audiences invested. And if you don't find that kind of, like, X factor for your games as a service game, there's a good chance that you're just not going to break through the pack. You're going to get lost in the cloud of or the sea of all the other games as a service.
I mean, one thing also is that like the original Factions was packed in with the
first game.
Like, and that used to be how multiplayer worked. Like the idea of a standalone multiplayer game was something that people looked at, you know, side eye. Like that wasn't
like, why am I paying almost like full price for multiplayer, or paying full price for multiplayer with some games?
Which was a
It was a weird hump to get over in the industry.
Time, we also saw this weird push about the time The Last of Us came out, where a bunch of single-player games were forced to have multiplayer because they had to have multiplayer. And, like, you know, you had stuff like Mass Effect 3 had a multiplayer mode. That wasn't what people signed up for. That's not why people like Mass Effect.
It was
Metroid Prime 2 had a multiplayer. Like, they were like, hey, four Samus is running around. It was, like, so stupid.
It's a weird choice. But, yeah, I mean...
It says you just probably got blasted more, Brian. Then you blasted other people. It wasn't a great. It wasn't a great multiplayer mode.
But no, to Max's point, it's like the multiplayer modes, like that one and the one in the Uncharted games existed because you were like, this gameplay is so awesome. I finished the campaign. I platinum it or whatever. I beat it on the hardest difficulty. I still want more.
Yeah.
And there you had it, right there. And it was to capitalize off the fact that there was like. Something rock solid about the foundation of that gameplay, and you wanted to keep the party going literally with your friends. And like Call of Duty's always had the opposite thing where they're like the single player modes are like kind of there, and I think of the most audience just like plays the multiplayer and skips over it. But it is interesting to me to be like it feels like The Last of Us multiplayer should have existed alongside a Last of Us single player game. And it's all one cohesive package. And then it feels like it's all, and then it's like, if it's just okay, at least Last of Us 3 is there and it kicks ass, right?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I don't know. It just, it always felt like a little odd to me.
Yeah. It's an odd fit. We're going to talk about Spider-Man sneakers, but I feel like an easier segue would be to talk about how The Last of Us, in addition to not being a multiplayer game, is in fact a theme park attraction.
Yeah.
Akeem, you went and checked out the Hollywood Horror Nights.
Yes, I did. But before that, I actually had a lot to add to that last conversation.
Ahead, go
but I really, I wanted to let you all talk. I feel like there's a lot of things that
you gotta just.
That
it's Ryan it's like
said.
A battle royale.
I don't want to steamroll anyone here. I don't like.
Do it. Do it.
Like, do it.
You all were on a roll. I'm like, I'm just gonna let them say their piece and.
Thank you, but just you know, elbow drop one of us next time and just you know,
just come off the top ropes.
I think a lot of it is just like them being. Overly ambitious about this multiplayer game. Like, I mean, like that May report said, you know, quality and long-term viability came into question. Like, why not just put it out? Like, you know, Jada, you mentioned, you know, how Fortnite started out. Like, I think just put the game out. I feel like there's people internally that are like making these decisions that are like looking at it internally. I mean, we only got two JPEGs. Like we haven't seen any gameplay footage of it. So it's like, I mean, they're deciding that internally that, you know, quality and long-term viability. We don't know. We didn't see any early footage of it, you know?
Yeah.
And to, like, even, you know, if you don't, I mean, to segue a little bit into, like, Halloween Horror Nights, like, that was something that was 2 years in the making. It doesn't normally take that long to conceptualize these mazes. Again, I think there's people that are internally that are perfectionists. I'm not going to say any names specifically. But I think there are people internally that are just perfectionists about The Last of Us as you know, as an IP.
Yeah.
And that's what it is more than anything else.
No, I was going to add on, like, Akeem, you hit the nail on the head. Like, I think there's a lot of game developers that are coming out and doing these, like, more experimental or new things that their studio aren't like super familiar with. And they release it in early access. They do betas or demos and we're like, hey, this is rough. Like, but we want to get community feedback. We want to know what it is. The Last of Us for Naughty Dog is like their top shelf type thing.
Yeah.
It's one of those things they don't want to tarnish by having something that is seen as less than or perceived as less than perfect. Like they want to keep that prestige.
And I mean,
even
beyond Naughty Dog, like Sony.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
this 100%. This is the crown jewel of their PlayStation Studios. Like this is the thing that gets an HBO show because it's so good. Like it is a prestige drama in video game form. It also gets a theme park attraction because it's a recognizable IP. Like it can stand on its own. They don't really have the leeway to just drop a
stinker.
Yeah, they can't drop a stinker. Just
what
clickers.
They perceive might be a stinker because we we're judging this on two JPEGs. Very. Very tiny JPEGs.
Can't just lay an egg and walk away.
Yeah, you can't just lay a JPEG egg.
But I think about like the way I interacted with like Halo Infinite, right? Which was like another big crown jewel for Microsoft. Mm-hmm. And like I played through the single player campaign. And I was like, cool, that was fun. And then I played the multiplayer game for like a month with friends. Like Max, I think you and I hopped on a couple times. Like we had a good time. And then I was like, cool, got my fill and moved on. And like that's not what they want from gamers for games like this. That is a completely normal behavior for the average person to do, but they want something that's all consuming, that takes all of your time and all of your money, and you basically play nothing else. Like Fortnite kids are not really jumping over to a bunch of other stuff. Call of Duty people are just stuck on those games, right? Like even the people who played PUBG or played it for a while.
Yeah.
Like for a while, they're
online. Those people that still
Counter-Strike. It's the same thing.
For like 10 years, they were like, I'm a Minecraft streamer. That's all I stream. Not me, but like people would say that. And so I think like the habits of a just a, you know, not necessarily, I wouldn't call myself a casual gamer, but when it comes to something like Halo Infinite, I'm like, well, I never really cared about this IP, but like I'll give it a shot. Had some fun with it.
You're like a general. You're like a generalist when it comes to gaming. Yeah. Like variety. Variety player, general player, the kind of, it's the kind of, I'm the same way.
Yeah. And I think like I kicked it $12. I bought like some skins or something like that. And I had some fun times and moved on with my life. And and then I saw all the community being like, this sucks. It's a letdown. They're not like updating new maps and stuff like that. Because those people were like, I want this to be my main game. Mm-hmm. And you don't have enough for me to make it that right now. And I could totally see that happening with The Last of Us. Like people are just like, they get invested in it. They click, they dump a bunch of money early on. And then they're sitting around for months or years being like, hey, when's season two? When's season three? Mm-hmm. When's the next drop?
Like The Last of Us as an IP, like it works great for like somber, character driven drama, that kind of thing. It doesn't really have as high of a ceiling for wackadoo, you know, multiplayer antics as something like Fortnite does. Like you can't just be like, great news, everybody, we're adding golf cart jumps into The Last of Us. Like, cool, Thanos is here and he wants to shake his ass. Like you don't get to do that. Like you can't.
We
just
saw
be
that
like,
with.
Hey,
and Max, you and I talked about this years ago when it came to Red Dead. We were like, GTA Online, you're going to get like helicopters and jetpacks and like gold-rimmed jets and all this stuff. And Red Dead, it was just like, pogo sticks are here, folks.
Yeah. Not even.
Now you can ride donkeys.
I was hoping they would get all like Wild Wild West with it and put in like giant robot spiders and like...
Oh, man, it would have been great. Yeah. I would have played way longer.
Submarine blimps or whatever. I don't know. Yeah.
Jackable steam trains.
Akeem, did you have more to add to the to your point? I know I jumped in.
I really just wanted to kind of just like, I wanted us to hone in on that. I think it's more so like the people internally that are just, you know, making these decisions because they're a bit of perfectionists. And I kind of saw that when I did go to Hollywood Horror Nights, October 1st, the first of the spooky month. I got to say, The Last of Us, the maze was amazing. I really did enjoy it. I had to say it, of course. So the maze covers the Pittsburgh quarantine zone. So when you're walking in, you know, you see the Pittsburgh military zone sign, which, you know, you might remember from the video game. You also find yourself in the suburbs where you meet Henry and Sam. Henry and Sam aren't in the maze, though. It's mostly just a bunch of people that, you know, are like, they just look like knockoff versions of Ellie and Joel.
Well,
and they're just like,
spoiler,
just like running around in the background, kind of.
Well, spoiler, they're, Henry and Sam don't make it, so not surprised that they're not there.
Stop!
Don't spoil the maze.
You just spoiled the maze. That's why they're not there. And yet, so the attention to detail in the maze too is great because you see when you're deep in the sewer a section of the maze, you even see like some of the drawings from Sam on the wall. So there's like little
cool
Easter eggs. And throughout the maze with the actors that they have portraying Joel and Ellie, they're lip syncing to new audio that Troy Baker and Ashley Johnson recorded.
Oh, weird.
Just for the maze.
Isn't it like lip synced by the actors too, right?
What?
You said they record as fresh audio. What, is it the actual actors talking, or is it like,
the scare actors. So those are the people that are in the maze. So the Ellie and Joel scare actors is what they call them.
Yes. Yeah, like no. Troy Baker and Ashley Johnson are not trapped in this maze for the whole season.
you have people who have to like, they have to like TikTok along with like the recording of Troy Baker and Ashley Johnson doing the voices and stuff that they did for a game where it mocapped their face and made computer people talk for them, like in the game. That's just
man, if you put it like that's
I mean, that sounds overly complicated.
I think they probably could have just had the people talking, but then I guess it wouldn't have the same, you know,
wouldn't have that same like cohesion, I guess.
Well, the thing is also, the thing is like it's piped through, you know, the loudspeaker, so it's like they're talking like this, Ellie, you gotta come over there. I'm gonna go save you.
So you know what would have been a really easy fix for this, for the scare actors, is gas masks. They should have just had gas masks on the whole time.
There is a scene where Joel is actually wearing a gas mask. Again, the attention to detail, and I feel like you'll only know this if you have played the video game. So they acknowledge the whole thing with like Ellie not being able to swim. So Joel has to start a generator to jumpstart a motorized platform. Now, if you're just walking through the maze and you have no knowledge of that from playing the video games, you just see Joel like trying to start a generator in one room, and it just looks weird. It's just like, oh, no one there. I'm gonna come save you, Ellie. And it's just like, what? Why is this important to me? Like, why am I?
I can't believe they leaned on the can't swim thing. That was such a like a joke after the first game.
Yeah.
And again, like I love that. I love that so much. And you know what we get from like video games and from the TV show, you know, we get to see it, but like you actually get to experience it. Like I got to touch the cordyceps on the walls.
Oh,
the stalkers and the clickers were on point. No, this was in just the maze. just the
did
maze.
Did they say you were allowed to do that, or did you just do it?
Well, it's a wall. No one's gonna say, don't touch the cordyceps on the walls.
Museums are full of walls you can't touch.
Well, they didn't blockade the walls. It's just like, you know, I just touched it. You can't touch the scare actor. So the clickers were coming right at me.
Okay.
Face to face, like right here, clicking right in my face.
Did you want to hit? Did you want to punch him?
No, I don't. No, I don't want to get infected.
But you'll touch the cordyceps on the wall.
I was fully immersed. Towards the end of it, you see the bloaters, and I remember talking to you all about this in our meeting just yesterday. How it's so everything else looked on point, even the actors as Joel and Ellie, although Ellie looked a little bit older than what she actually is in the part one. But of course, it's a full immersion. I just was immersed in everything. But anyways, towards the end of the maze, you see the bloaters. And I think they needed a little bit more time to bake in the FX kitchen, because they looked like just flesh tone transformers. Like it just looked like Bumblebee with like flesh.
That's horrible.
That actually sounds more horrifying than a regular bloater.
I'm intrigued. I've
always that is like, yeah, one of the worst. That's one of the worst visuals you've ever put in my head.
Bumblebee, where'd you get the flesh from?
They announced the new Transformers, where the Transformers turn from robots into just slightly larger people, but they're like the size.
Yeah, they're
of
called
cars.
Mansformers. Yeah.
Mansformers.
Fleshy.
No, thank you. Yeah,
and just to point this out for those, so I definitely say if you're a fan of The Last of Us, and of course like all of the mazes are great. Like Chucky was one of my favorite ones. He had like a kill count going through his maze. But if you're a fan of The Last of Us video game, I would definitely. If you find yourself in Hollywood, I would check it out. If you find yourself in Orlando, I would check it out over there as well. Both mazes were made by two different creative teams, so they both, although they both cover the Pittsburgh quarantine zone, you'll get a different experience in either. So
that rules.
Of course they're trying
that's
to encourage
cool.
people to yeah they want to encourage people to
fly across the country and
yeah,
try them both.
Exactly.
I think it's, I mean, this says a lot about sort of where we're at with video games in terms of it being like a mainstream, you know, form of media, but like The Last of Us is maybe like one of the hardest M-rated games out there. Like it's yeah. brutal, it's gnarly. Mm-hmm. And then Mario is probably the furthest opposite end of the spectrum possible, and both yep. of these things got massively successful, critically well received, you know,
media pieces of media,
yeah, a show and a movie, mm-hmm. respectively, and they also get like theme park rides.
Yep,
which mm-hmm. is just okay. That's yep. an interesting approach, but why not? It works, I guess.
Yeah,
yeah. I think video games particularly are especially well suited to being, you know, theme park attractions.
Yep,
and I yeah. feel like we're going to see more of this. I know that they had, I think they had a Silent Hill bit at Halloween Horror Nights a few years ago.
I believe so.
The Pyramid Head
yes.
floating around.
Yes.
It could have just been a cosplayer interloping and causing a ruckus.
Well,
but
I saw there was a thing
yeah,
going
I mean,
on Twitter the other day where somebody pointed out
sort of, you know, we talk about set pieces in games, and that's like a theme park ride. But I was kind of thinking about, you know, some other ones that could totally work really well. Uncharted seems like a no brainer.
Give me a train ride.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, arguably like probably an easier kind of widespread sell. Compared to The Last of Us, which is
right.
you know, that's scary. People don't like, they don't always like being scared, but everyone
also
likes...
like also really works the only the best during spoopy season.
That's true.
So
yeah.
like whereas Uncharted kind of yeah. works year round.
Yeah. I mean it's just Indiana Jones, but with like a different shirt, you know?
Yeah.
Pretty much.
And it's not the 40s, you know. That's an option. I'm kind of surprised we haven't seen an Assassin's Creed one, because that seems like a really, like the whole idea of like leaping off of stuff. I think they've regularly had like activations to promote Assassin's Creed at like Comic-Con and stuff.
Yep.
It's like one of those big stupid swings where they hoist you up and you just go, and you go swinging.
They also, they did, I think it was like 2015, 2016, they had like a Ninja Warrior kind of course that I ran for Assassin's Creed, and I got like a cool little Assassin's Creed shirt and stuff for doing it. It was really cool.
I love that. I mean, I could see Bioshock working really well just because it's so iconic kind of visually and location-wise.
And I think Bioshock would work well just kind of on its own, whether people like going into the attraction know that it's a video game or not. I think it's so distinctive that it would work really well.
Yeah, you're like, you get attacked by a big weird submarine looking man.
Yep.
I feel like the way that these corporate companies do it is like they try to see how successful a certain IP is in other mediums. So like, let's put a movie out there. Let's put a TV show out there as well. So, you know, I feel like a Fallout one, because Fallout is getting its own TV series, am I right?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so I think that's one way, like, you know, these corporations like kind of like, you know, figure out like what would possibly work as like a theme attraction is by just like seeing how successful it might be in either television or as a movie. So like in other mediums, like, so I mean, we're going to get a God of War series. So I would love to see a God of War theme park attraction. I think that'd be pretty sick.
I mean,
on Axis.
I mean, we did get that Disneyland ride in Ragnarok. So why not? Let's just, you know.
Yeah, I mean,
you can make that in real life.
The appeal of games is like being there and interacting with things. And it's like, I think it's an easier, I mean, I imagine making a theme park ride is probably a bit of more of an undertaking than making a show or a movie, depending on the subject matter. But like, it's also, I don't know, you set up a crazy haunted house type thing, like The Last of Us set up. And it's
right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yep.
All right. So shifting gears here. Oh, man.
I got this one.
Okay.
So in honor of it being Mean Girls Day, because we wear pink on Mean Girls Day. It's October 2nd, y'all.
Yo.
But what's something that's also very pink? Foamstars. We had the beta, the public beta over the weekend. I played a whole bunch. I had a blast. Oh, my goodness.
What?
Yes, Akeem. Yes.
Akeem has a large bubble gun that says Foamstars on it.
You just bubbled your mic.
Yeah, this is official. This is official property. This is an official item that I got.
Is it?
Playing the beta. Yeah. I played the beta and I won this.
Oh, man. All I got were VIP screens.
Loose. I platinum the beta.
Okay, so you guys keep saying beta. It's this. Not a beta. It was a foam party. Okay,
it was a foam party.
Foam party that everyone was invited to, and only some people went to it. But the people who went to it, I think, liked it. Did you like it?
I loved it. I actually had a blast. I mean, I've already made my thoughts clear. Like I talked about it when I played it at PAX. I got to play it a lot more over the weekend. They had the two game modes, which was Smash the Star and then Happy Bath Survival. Pretty much played almost just Smash the Star, played a little bit of Happy Bath Survival, but Smash the Star is great. It was a lot of fun. I got to try out a bunch of the different characters, not all of them. Rave Breaker, still my favorite. He's got this foam thrower, and I was just sneaking up behind people and just assassinating whole parties. I was getting like 3 and 4 chills. You don't get kills.
I get it.
It's all about they make it very clear. If you played the beta, they make it very clear at the beginning, like, hey, we're here to have a good time and spread cheer and good, just like. Like it's the vibe we're going for, we're cultivating. So there's no kills in Foamstar. You get chills, and so like you get multi chills or whatnot. It sounds silly saying it out loud, but it's really cool. I really like the vibe too. It's got this like Persona flavor.
I was not expecting it to be so Persona. Yeah, it's got like a very like Persona 5 soundtrack to it.
Yeah.
I like the art style. I don't know if it works well in practice.
Mm-hmm.
Like I saw other people complaining about this, but the fact that you've got these incredibly bright colors in the foreground and just like very dark, you know, kind of Vegas skyline backdrop, which makes it, there's a lot going on. It's visually very busy, which it clearly leans into.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I think the big thing is if you've wanted to try Splatoon, but you don't really care for Nintendo's online servers and stuff like that, this is going to kind of fill that void for you. This is going to give you that that kind of hero shooter kind of vibe, because I mean, it's different from Splatoon, where Splatoon does have a little bit of that hero shooter where you can customize out like your one of your specials and your weapon and stuff like that. But here for Foamstars, all the different characters, they have, you know, they have a superstar finish, they have a like, and then they have like skills or whatever they're called in this one.
Yeah.
That are all unique to each of the characters and stuff.
Akeem, did you get a chance to play for real?
No, I didn't, unfortunately.
You just have a fake gun?
I was too busy running around town to purchase this that I missed the beta. I think it was worth it, though.
I played a little bit. It's like gag. It's very fat, very short rounds.
Yeah,
I appreciate.
I think like most of them are like 8 minutes or something like that.
It feels like it's over pretty quickly. There's definitely, you know, there's room for improvement. It's a beta. It's or a foam beta, whatever it's called.
Foam party.
It's interesting. I was kind of poking around, just sort of to, you know, testing the waters and seeing what people thought of it. And like on Reddit, people were just ripping it apart. They just hated it. They did not like it. They did not like how fast you moved, etc. Over on Resetera, people were like much more positive, but they did flag one thing I think is really a very valid point. And I probably should be paying attention to this stuff better. I forgot that this was a PS4 and 5 exclusive, which it is. And that I don't think is good. I don't think that's good in this instance, because with a multiplayer game like this, you really need to cultivate as big of a player base as possible. Yeah. And having the walled garden approach does not work. And I'm just getting kind of Destruction All-Star vibes about that.
Yeah, that does worry me when it comes to the longevity of it. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping that it's just a more of a, hey, we're developing for PlayStation 4 and 5 first, and then we're going to release it on other consoles, PC, and stuff. Like, after, just, we're trying to keep development costs down while so we develop for one console, and then as we release it, make some money.
Like, we don't know if it's a like a retail game or like a paid thing.
Yeah, I haven't heard.
It's, if you just go to the page on the PSN store, it's just like wish list or like find out more, that kind of thing. But yeah, I mean, I could see this. If they tighten it up and they kind of address some of the issues people had with it, I could see it doing well if it is on, you know, PlayStation Plus at the baseline level, at the very you know, entry level thing, because that, you know, that has worked really well in the past for stuff like, you know, Fall Guys and Rocket League. Like, it's, you can get people's attention by, you know, having something that, like, oh, I guess I'll give it a
just making the barrier to entry very low.
Yeah. And I worry that if they don't do that, they're completely going to just screw themselves over, and, you know, it'll be yet another game that just kind of comes and goes. And then just, you know, disappears into the ether, just washed away like foam and rain.
Honestly, I hope that's not the case, because I feel like we've been hyping up this game for so long. I paid way too much money for that freaking Foamstars gun just now.
What? You said you won that at an event.
I won too much money. I mean,
You won too
much money. What is that like, Akeem, to win too much money? How much money is that? What is that like?
Well, Akeem, I do have good news. You're going to save $70 this year. You know why? Because Activision announced they're canceling Call of Duty after they played this beta. They said they're not doing it.
What? Really?
There's no point anymore.
They said the foam source is too good, and why bother? That's what they said. They said, chills, we should have thought of that. We've always been killing people, but what if we were chilling people instead?
What if we were putting them on ice?
Yeah, just cultivating good vibes.
Yeah. Call of Duty's on thin ice, and so are you, Call of Duty fans.
They're not even like clear about what
new shooter in town.
What the foam is, because there's like a barista player, and there's an ice cream lady, and then there's also like soap.
Yeah, and then there's Penguin. Yeah.
Yeah, so Penguin's notoriously foamy animal. What's going on there? I don't know what...
There's foamy foam in this. I'm confused. There's foam.
Well, that's game. It's called crema.
Yeah,
the top of your espresso.
You know, you get a nice the frappuccino.
I think that's one of the characters. The deal.
Steamed milk. I don't know. It's what it is. You steam the milk. You get all frothy. Make a nice macchiato.
I'm so jealous, Max and Jada, that you all got to play this. And, you know, I mean, like, I feel like Brian and I, we have that some FOMO going on here. Because like,
you could have played it.
Yes, we do. Brian, you're the one who approved me purchasing this, remember?
Yeah, it's on your expense report.
I have not received that expense report.
I thought you better approve it.
Well, what'd you write? Did you put foam gun?
I just put foam. I feel like if I put gun, you would not approve it. So I just put foam.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, it's the foam parts that's the issue.
I don't want to. Okay. Well, I don't. I feel like we started. You broke me, man.
Max is flustered. What happened? What happened, Max? So
you said historically foamy animal penguin, and it just everything fell.
That's my favorite Mega Man boss. Historically foamy Mega Penguin. Man. Anyway, I like that we did start talking about Foamstars, kind of joking around about it, but there is a substantial game there.
Yeah.
Whether or not it is. I don't, again,
whether it's going to take off and, you know, set the world of a foam, mm-hmm. who knows?
You think the bubble will pop on the excitement?
I hope not. I hope that there are many bubbles in this bath for foam stars.
Okay. All right. God. All right. So speaking of historical animals, Brian and I played a bunch of a game called Pizza Possum. We're going to talk about that. For as long as we can.
Pizza possums are historical animals.
On our show, because it's really just a lost cause at this point. We got,
yes,
just everything's going sideways.
It's okay.
No, we checked out this game called Pizza Possum, and I'm an adult man. I'm saying this, I'm talking to my other friend. We both have children, and I guess that's one argument we could say for playing this game, but really it's a fun game about a possum that's there to steal some food and cakes, and it's going to eat a bunch of grapes. It's possum runs around. It's sort of like a very arcadey stealth game where basically... Yeah. You described it as Richard's Scary Pac-Man, which is astute.
Yeah, that's kind of from the trailers and stuff I watched. That's like I could see it without seeing it now.
It's like less than $7 on PlayStation right now, and it's just so much fun. I think Max and I both went in thinking it might be one of those like kind of instant pass fail stealth games. Like a lot of like stealth games come out and they're just like they make you redo stuff a lot. Mm-hmm. This one is way more frantic, way more silly. So the plot here is basically you're like this little French possum and you have to sneak around this like quaint beachside town where there are dogs patrolling everything and you have to eat all the food everywhere. And so like the types of characters in this game is you, the possum, there's dog guards, and then there's just various other animals.
Dog guards.
There's guard dog. Would you say that they're guard dogs?
They're guard dogs, yeah. I don't know why I said that wrong 5 times. And there's various other animals who just live there who are just like, oh no, a rat.
You're a villain. You're a real nuisance, and I appreciate that about it. Like they don't try to be like, you're the hero, you've got to save the possum princess. It's like, you are a little shit-eating rat, and you are here. Yeah. To ruin everyone's day.
It kind of reminds snickering the whole time. You're like cackling. If you eat too much too fast, you get like really heavy, really quick, and that's slow down momentarily. Like I said, like this game is like $7. It's not like exceptionally deep or anything, but it is such a delight.
It's really charming. It reminds me a little bit of Hotline Miami in that it's like it is very quick to just sort of spit you back out and get you doing the thing again. Mm. And it's like that. I think if it had any kind of like load screen or any kind of just like tedium to it, I would be very much not into it. But it is like that perfect kind of like just that feedback loop. And basically, you know, you collect food, you get points, whatever. And it has an interesting kind of structure for the world where you collect enough points, you get a key. And then there's a gate you can unlock. And basically, I was thinking that once you unlock them, they stay unlocked. But basically, after that, you have to find like a checkpoint. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes there's multiple gates before the checkpoint. So there's this kind of like, I know we do this all the time. It's not like Bloodborne in any way, shape or form, but it does have that kind of, you know, that you always say like the GTA Chinatown wars, that kind of like that gambling aspect where you're like running around trying to get as many points as possible to do the thing. But, you know, the greedier you get, the more of a risk it is. And that's
some folks are saying it's like the Dark Souls of possum games.
I would say that.
You know. Are you joking? Probably.
No, I'm joking.
Okay. I would say that. I'd second that, Brian.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's very cute. I played it with my kid watching, and every time he would eat like an entire cake and just get like very large, she'd be like, "He got a tummy ache," and I was like, "Yeah, he does. He ate a whole cake. Don't ever do that unless I'm there."
Yeah,
too.
It's very funny, and I think like what's awesome is that is like you have to kind of like bob and weave your way to the top of this mountain where there's like a king dog who's just sitting in front of a gigantic pizza, and like when you get to there's smaller pizzas and pastas and snacks and baguettes everywhere, cakes. There's like hidden like kind of pastries that you have to find. And if when you get to the top, like you have to eat this entire pizza in front of this king, and all of his guards are like, "Oh no." And then you eat it and he gets pissed off. You get his crown. And then you start back down at the bottom again. But on your way up, like there's all these different paths you can choose to take. And so by eating stuff, you get a key, you open up the door and you keep moving your way up the mountain. And so like, it's just really, really fun. Like it just feels like every time you play, it's a little bit different, and there's different variations you can take up to the top of the mountain.
It's
different large pastries and you know, there's like a, what is it? The, you know, there's like a huge bowl of pasta. There's, you know, a Capri salad.
Yeah. I like the,
when you get to the top and you eat the royal pizza and you, mm-hmm. you collect the crown, what happens after that? So you're just spat back out to the bottom, or do you become like
after that you have to take out three
something?
Umbilical cords, yeah. and then you fight the moon dream king of the dogs, and then you you find out that you were dead the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it really is the Bloodborne of possum games.
Akeem, it brings you back to the bottom of the mountain where you have a crown, and then you have to do it again, and if you get all three, something magical happens. But I'm not good enough to do that yet. I'm gonna keep practicing stealing that king's food.
It's because you only get two it's hard, you only get two lives, you know. It's really the Sekiro mm-hmm. of possum games.
It's actually, yep. they don't actually show what happens. There's no play. Is there any playing dead? I feel like there's not really. Is that coming to play at all?
Because that's you can hide in a bush.
That's all possums do, is they play dead. They like fake their own deaths, and then, you know, theoretically the dogs would leave them alone. But mm-hmm. that's the possum has a mechanic built into it, and they didn't even do anything with that. I don't know if they did any proper, it could very easily just be like a cat or a raccoon or something, but they went with possum, yeah. I guess, for alliteration's sake.
Alliteration sells.
Yeah, there's a lot of different, Peter you Parker. Know, like, there's different paths you can take and different, you know, weapons you can unlock. So I guess it's sort of like the Elden Ring of possum games.
It kind of is maybe the Elden Ring of anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, so let's talk about other animal creature people. Some tidbits about Spider-Man. Obviously, that's rapidly approaching. Adidas announced this morning that they're doing a Spider-Man 2 advanced suit and symbiote-inspired shoes. This has the biggest mouthful of word salad official name possible, which is Adidas Peter Parker Advanced Suit and Venom Collection, which is coming out October 20th, and it features a variety of training footwear and apparel, including Ultra Boost J and Ultra 4D sneakers, the Adizero 12.0 football cleat, sweatshirts, compression tights, and more, made for gamers and athletes alike. And also, apparently, people in Marvel's New York, officially titled that, I don't know why it's called Marvel's, I guess it is that universe is New York, they're going to be wearing some Adidas stuff, too. Yeah, it feels like they're kind of going all out here. They only showed one sneaker so far, and it just looks like if you were wearing regular Spider-Man shoes and then stepped in tar really hard.
Yeah.
Which is, that's, mm-hmm. yeah.
That's Venom.
Yeah. Is it, or is it roofing tar? Who's to say? but that's cute. They also dropped a new CGI launch trailer, which, are CGI launch trailers at, or CGI trailers at launch, are they okay? Is that, do they get a pass there if they've shown enough?
If we've seen enough gameplay already, I think it's fine.
Yeah. Because we got that big during the state of play with the whole lizard chase and stuff like that. So, like, yeah, I think, and also, like, we know what the gameplay for Spider-Man looks like. Like, it's not like an unknown quantity. Mm-hmm. Like, we know what the Spider-Man, like, if we hadn't seen, let's say, like, Wolverine did the same thing and we hadn't seen any Wolverine gameplay and they're just like, hey, here's your launch trailer, CG, that's it.
I actually really like, you know, I like CG trailers, but not when that's just all we get, you know?
Yeah,
like, I
no,
think
for sure.
Cool as, like, tone pieces or whatever. But this one, yeah, it's gorgeous. You know, I feel like it's not super mind-blowing or anything, but as far as these ones go, it's definitely, it looks like the Spider-Man games do for the most, like, it's obviously much more polished and stuff, mm-hmm. but, like, compared to, like, the CG trailer for, like, Death Stranding, which makes it look, like, super action-packed, I was like... I don't know if that's really selling the experience.
I think for me, like, I never want a CG trailer first. I always want to see gameplay first.
No.
I think a lot of developers kind of fall into that where they're like, hey, we've got this cool CG trailer that's ready. Let's use this to promote because the gameplay is not ready to, like, be captured and showcased without
Personally,
bugs and stuff.
My favorite way is when they reveal two JPEGs and then I don't play the game for years.
That is great.
That's forever.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like to see two JPEGs, and I like to watch an HBO show and then go to the theme park. That's my proper mm-hmm. gaming experience.
And then you put the JPEGs on ice.
There we go. Mm-hmm. There's also a blog post up talking about Spider-Man 2's accessibility features, which is kind of awesome. And I think it's interesting. You know, I'm sure there are plenty of sort of able-bodied folks who just kind of don't care about this stuff. But if you dig into them, there's also a lot of really cool features that can just be utilized for, you know, for the hell of it. There's a audio frequency cutoff, which lets you adjust the sort of highs and lows, and which, I don't know, everyone's sound system is different. Mm-hmm. And I feel like very often just things are just mixed weird.
Yeah.
Like my home setup is constantly pissing me off, and I'll switch between streaming services and, you know, blow a hole through my wall because one of them's inexplicably louder than the other. You know, if I'm playing a game at like 5:30 in the morning, I'm like, I don't want to wake everyone up and, you know, having cars getting blown up by, you know, criminals or whatever I'm doing, Mortal Kombat. I actually had a really funny thing. I turned on Mortal Kombat 1 for the first time, and I started, like, this was literally at like 5 in the morning as I woke up for no reason, and I started it up, and they do the thing where they, like, have accessibility options turned on. By
oh, yeah.
And I turned it on, and I've got, like, it turned down pretty quiet, and the logo pops up, and it just goes, Mortal Kombat 1. And I was like, wow, did their announcer just start doing therapy or something? Like, what happened there? And then I realized it was just the screen reader turned on.
Yeah.
I kind of liked it, though. I sort of like if they were just, you know, we got a lot of games that just shout their name at you.
Just, did, you know, whisper. Give me some ASMR for my your screen reading.
Did you guys see the thing about the swinging options, which I believe one of the devs said was, like, the opposite of accessibility in terms of, like, like the swinging in the game, in the base game, when you install it or put your disc in, it is like set to 10 in terms of like how much it kind of assists you.
Oh, okay.
So like holding R, it's basically set to where it was kind of maxed out in the previous games, I believe they said. Mm-hmm. But you can drop it down so you have like a ton more customization in terms of like your actual control and maneuverability.
Oh, that's cool.
In swinging around corners and stuff like that. So like, you can literally swing on hard mode in Spider-Man 2 if you want
that's
to.
Cool. We talked about there was like what like a thing going around about fall damage.
Yep, there's damage.
That's fun.
I'm playing with fall damage when I get it for sure. Hands down. Cannot wait.
Also, we talked about this before with game speed, which I think is a really cool solution. And they had a note in here that had never occurred to me. You know, obviously this is great if you just want some more time to like take things in and just, you know, not get your ass kicked. But also photo mode.
Yeah.
This is like a great solution if you're just trying to like line up a perfect shot and like it's, you know, it's frequently very hard to pop into photo mode when you're,
yep,
you know, whatever, fighting a bunch of people.
I know like Insomniac's really good usually about adding like hotkeys and stuff for it, but even then still like doing a bunch of like actions to set up a shot and then like if you flub the button and miss it by a frame and it's just a blur, it's just like,
and you can also map shortcuts to the L&R and the D-pad, which just seems like kind of awesome. Like I don't know, that wasn't the case in the previous ones, was it? I can't remember.
I think Ratchet and Clank had it. I think Rift Apart had that, but I don't think the previous Spider-Man.
That kind of rules. I'm definitely excited to mess with this. But yeah, that is a handful of you know, little bits of
Spider news.
Man, we have had this thing in the run of show that's been getting kicked down the road for just like weeks at this point, which is the Final Fantasy VII Rebirth segue versus the Like a Dragon Infinite Wealth segue. Should we argue about the segue right now?
Let's do it. I think so. We got time. Let's do it.
All right. We're definitely going to do that thing that we always do, where we talk about something for a second, and then we completely run out of steam, and then we're like, oh, we don't have the full-length amount of show to talk about. Anyway, so yeah, we got reveals for Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, where it showed Cloud riding around on a Segway.
Yeah.
Kind of a silly addition.
It's very silly.
Also got Like a Dragon Infinite Wealth, which has Ichiban Kasuga riding around on a Segway, which is, I feel like, a much more...
Segways, all the rage in 2023.
It really an odd addition to two massive, you know, Japanese games, two JRPGs. Having it in Yakuza feels like, you know, they were doing research. It's the new one set in Hawaii. It kind of makes sense that they would have, you know, somebody scooting around in a Segway, like they saw a tourist go by doing that. That checks out. The fact that they had to go out of their way to be like, yeah, let's put a Segway in Final Fantasy VII. Why not? If you showed somebody a Segway when the original Final Fantasy VII came out, they would think that was a vehicle from Final Fantasy VII because it's a nonsense science fiction vehicle. So my question to you is this, is realistically, if you had to ride a Segway, would you rather do it in a Final Fantasy realm, off in the land of Gaia, Midgar, whatever the hell, or would you rather do it on a regular old vacation in Honolulu? Jada?
I have to go with in Honolulu with Yakuza, mostly because if I'm riding anything in Final Fantasy's world, it's going to be a chocobo.
Fair
point. Like, there's no point. Why would I stand when I could sit while riding and climb mountains? The Segway in Final Fantasy is not going to be able to climb mountains or fly through the sky or run across water.
That's an interesting angle. You know, that's your thinking pragmatically.
I am.
You
know? I'm always very
Segway
pragmatic.
Is one of the most ludicrous things you can ride in Hawaii, whereas in, you know, in Final Fantasy, dream bigger. Brian, what about you?
What's the state of the world in both of these circumstances? Like, what's happening at those exact moments? Because I know things aren't going great in Final Fantasy during the events that one would be riding this Segway.
I mean,
right?
The world's just kind of dying, but,
well,
you know,
also
what's
in
new?
That world, I don't think you would be same. The hero, Brian. You might just be like someone that's in the world. Like, you're not going to be, you know.
It's true. It's true. You might not have enough animal handling skill to, you know, to raise a chocobo.
I don't
hurt.
Yes, that was a Baldur's Gate 3 reference.
Oh, I didn't mean it like that. I just,
no, no,
I
it's
just
fine.
But you don't have that anime hair that kind of, you know, heroes are
wow.
known for.
Wow. Low blow.
What?
Low blow. Well, high blow, I guess, technically. It's on top of
that. That's a two-hit combo. That was two in a row. yes, but I would still, I wouldn't have to deal with the anime hair, but I would still find it ridiculous, A. And B, if the world was going south and going horrible, I'd still have to deal with the repercussions of it, right? Even if I wasn't directly responsible for fixing it, right? And so I feel like if Yakuza, the stakes are mostly low, it's like some gangs are rough and toughing some people and they're dealing, you know, I've lived in cities before. I can hold my own and, you know how to, you know, not get into tussles when needed. But like if the whole world is falling apart because of like some evil magician villain or whatever the hell is happening in Final Fantasy, then yeah, I don't want to deal with all that. Look at this. You go swimming in the ocean. I love to swim in the ocean. Do they even have oceans?
Ride a Segway
into the ocean.
I don't think I would do that in either of these places.
don't do that.
Akeem, what are your thoughts on this? Where would you ride a Segway?
Well, I mean, the Final Fantasy world, of course. I mean,
am I allowed to insult him now? Or
yes.
Just,
yeah. Okay, yeah. No, go for it. You don't have to ask permission, fellas.
Just get out. Go nuts.
It wasn't intended as an insult.
I don't care. It's fine.
A fact. I was being very factual, and don't take it like that. But no, I would totally ride a Segway in the Final Fantasy world, just because. I mean, honestly, I've never ridden a Segway, and yet I'm looking at their website right now. They're highly affordable. The lowest priced one is like $400, which is insane to me.
That's like cheaper than PlayStation.
I feel like they were just
yeah,
which is weird, right? It's cheaper than a freaking
I swear to God, I thought they went out of business and that they didn't have a website anymore.
This is not a joke. I don't mean to. Like set it up as such. The inventor of the Segway literally drove a Segway off a cliff and died. Like they had a whole thing. Like they were a massive flop of an invention, and then another company scooped them up after the fact. There's a whole it's a podcast called Decoder Ring that does an incredible deep dive on the history of the Segway. It is baffling. It is completely mind-boggling. It is an absurd thing, and I'm somehow just completely just flabbergasted they're showing up in video games, let alone that they still exist. It's just a bizarre invention. Why this year?
Aren't they both out next year?
Next year. Why next year?
Yeah. Max, was it Obi-Wan or Andor, the show that just had like the regular ass Boston Dynamic dogs show up one episode? Do you remember that?
Yeah,
like they were like supposed to be droids, but they were just like
to me that's
the thing about Final Fantasy. Seeing a Segway in Final Fantasy is like, I don't know, it was one thing when like when they had like an actual car, you know,
mm-hmm.
and like the boys
and the motorcycle.
It's neither here nor there. It's from getting from here to there, but it is neither here nor there as far as vehicles go, because it's like I always liked in Iron Man 1, what's his face, Jeff Bridges, the bad guy, spoilers for a 27-year-old movie or whatever, he rides a Segway around, and like initially I think you'd watch it and be like, oh, look at this asshole, and like sure enough, that was the tell. It was foreshadowing. He rode a Segway, and he was mean.
Yep.
It's a ridiculous businessman vehicle.
What ridiculous form of transportation we think is going to return? We think those hoverboards are going to come back? Those two-wheeled, no handle?
Oh, man. We had to ban those from the IGN office at one point because people were just riding them around and crashing into other people, and it was just... Oh yeah,
Paul
Give
Blart
the
Mall
Paul...
Cop was literally inspired by how ridiculous the Segways were. Like those dudes saw one and they were like, "Let's write a movie about how terrible those things are. Who should ride it?" And then they created Paul. I'm not even making this up. It's in the Decoder Ring episode. It's really, it's very interesting. It makes me respect the Paul Blart media franchise a little bit more. The duology of Paul Blart films. And
wait, there was two of them?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Jada, have you ridden a Segway before? It's a yes or no question.
I don't think I have.
No.
I don't know.
Have I ridden?
I've traveled
Segways.
The world. I've been to like 8 countries. I don't remember if
any
I've ridden a Segway.
A Segway.
No, none of them. I didn't ride a Segway in any of those
Ryan,
countries.
Ryan, I know the answer to this question. You've not ridden a Segway.
No, I was on my honeymoon like 9 years ago in Paris, and my wife and I were like on this like very romantic bridge, and we were just like holding hands, walking around, and we were like thinking about how beautiful it was. And all of a sudden this extremely French guy went by in a Segway, and we both like almost hit the floor laughing so hard. Like we were in tears laughing. Cause I think it was like the first time I'd ever seen one like face to face in person. And it was, there was nothing else like it on that bridge. Like there was the guys with the bicycles and the baguettes, you know, and the carrots or whatever. The ones that
there was riding Segways look like, how I feel when I exercise.
Yeah, like, it looks so
just
dumb.
There's like a kinetic shame to it. I don't.
Yeah,
I remember back in Chicago. No, I've never, but I remember riding the bus way back when in Chicago. And
that's normal, though. That's a totally different vehicle.
Hold on. There's more to the story. Okay. Jeez. No, I never, but I remember riding the bus. No, that's not where the story ends. Okay, Brian. No, I remember riding the bus way back in the day in Chicago. All right, uh-huh. And seeing Segway tours taking place, people. You know, they have like a leader, you know, who's also on a Segway, like six people behind him. Like, and if you look over here, there's the Bean, and if you look over there, there's the Willis Tower. Yes, that's
it's
right.
It's called a tour guide, not a leader.
I'm the leader. What do you call them, tour guides? No, in Chicago. All right, Brian, I'm from Chicago. Okay,
I actually think they're I think it's actually pronounced guide tours. Is what they're called.
Guide tours.
Guide tours. They're not tour
Neither
guides.
Of you
they're
are
guide
from
tours.
Chicago. You don't know what they are called.
I think you're making stuff up. This is not a Chicago thing to call somebody a tour guide a leader.
Chicago is not a place I would ride a Segway because it's too windy, and I feel like that's really putting the whole like the balancing act of the Segway to the test.
Think Many about people this, have though. Fallen off, and it's been hysterical.
Yeah,
that.
No, they're a ridiculous vehicle.
It is one of the funniest vehicles to see someone fall off.
I would not ride a Segway in Hawaii because I feel like I would see someone I knew or someone who would see me, and they'd be like, "Hey, you look familiar, and you're on a Segway. What's up with that?" And I would be like, "Oh no!" So either I would
just
wear
speed
a,
away.
I would just they don't go that fast. I would either need an elaborate disguise to ride a Segway,
which would fit in the Yakuza world.
Yeah, that's a fair point. That's a very good point. They added disguises to the upcoming the man who forgot his own name or whatever it's called.
Erased his name.
Side mission.
But yes.
Gaiden, whatever. But then if I had to ride it in Final Fantasy, I feel like it would really like it, much like in Chicago, be putting the Segway to the test because you'd have a giant Buster Sword on your back, and I feel like that's just going to be really a huge. You know, strain on your lumbar, probably.
I could see you wielding a Buster Sword. I was going to say, you're putting yourself in the Buster Sword camp? That's what you'd wield?
I could see you with a sword. Thanks. I couldn't see you on a Segway or in a disguise, and both together would kill me.
Good to know.
Like, if you put on a big costume and you got on a Segway, I would laugh so hard I would die.
I know. I think I talked about like getting a bicycle once, and you were like, you just started making fun of the idea of me riding a bicycle.
I just can't picture it. You're 7 feet tall. You can't be in a bicycle. You know,
one of those big old penny farthings. Just ride that around.
Yeah, you walk like the bad guys in War of the Worlds. Like you can't go on a bicycle. You're too tall. You're like a stilt guy at the circus. You can't do it.
So maybe in that sense, the Segway is a good vehicle because I don't have to move my legs at all. I can just kind of. You could even hide them. You get like a sort of podium around it, like a little. They have those.
Yeah, like how Akeem made fun of me, sure. And I was like, I don't really have any dirt on Akeem, so I'll just make fun of Max.
yeah, Max has this very tall torso, so his body kind of like. Wobbles.
Yeah, this is it. This is Max when he wakes up in the morning.
For those of you listening at home, our producer is showing footage from the 2005 Steven Spielberg masterpiece, The War of the Worlds. Doing a good show today. Doing a real good job. Jada, you playing any video games? You got anything?
Oh my goodness. Yeah. I booted up Axiom Verge 2 the other night, which is Metroidvania kind of style game, and it rips. It's pretty cool. I played it for like maybe, I don't know, 2 hours. I beat like two bosses. But yeah, really cool little thing. And then I'm just kind of building out my list for my trophy sprint in December. I've got right now the preliminary list that I will eventually whittle down is right now at 29 games. I definitely will not be playing all 29. But I'll whittle that list down to about 16. I've got things in there like Gravity Rush, Infernax, considering doing Plague Tale Requiem, the Plague Tale sequel, because Plague Tale Innocence rocked, and I haven't played the sequel to that one yet. But yeah, I got a bunch of other rats. Stuff like that. Yeah, there's all the rats, you know.
So we actually were talking about this earlier, and this is something I want to kind of put out to our audience to chime in. What's the worst trophy of 2023? And I mean, there's obviously still some games, you know, to come still on the list, but you know, we always, people always like, they kind of pinpoint, you know, here's an easy game to platinum. Mm-hmm. But then occasionally you get those ones where like, here's a game I didn't platinum because of this thing.
This one trophy, like, this one thing.
It's tied to online. Maybe it's just an obscenely stupid, frustrating thing to do. There was like a Steam achievement, I think, that was like, have the game in your library for 10 years or something. It was, I want to say it was like Stanley Parable or some game like that.
Oh yeah. Very... There was another, there's also that, well, no, that was a, that's the, never mind, something else. But yeah. Yeah, no, there's some really wacky and weird trophy things. So one of them that I vetoed putting on my list was Sackboy's Adventure. Cause I haven't played through that yet. And I was like, oh, that'd be a fun little platinum at the end of the year. But you have to play like 20 missions in like co-op. So I'm like, I would have to force my partner to sit there and play this probably very simple platformer with me
you
for 20
just
missions.
Have a controller hooked up. And
that's what I was thinking.
Drag its dead carcass around.
That's what I was considering. So I was like, I'll test it and see, like, I'll try and get like the first multiplayer trophy with that. And if that works, then I'll just like, all right, then I can do it. But yeah, that's one of the ones I kind of veto just because of that. Like, I don't, one of them that I really dislike, mostly because I'm playing, I played it much later, was the first Dying Light. There is a trophy called Polyamory where you have to complete, I think it's 5 missions with the same party of 3 people in one session. And so it's
I thought that trophy name was going somewhere very different.
Yeah, no, it's just they just want you to be together killing things. So that's one of the ones that's kind of a bummer for me. Okay. Like, because, having to find a full party in Dying Light 1 nowadays is
should get be a trophy in of itself.
Yeah.
Yeah, dear listeners, send us an email beyond@ign.com. I got our ID department to make it so that stopped not getting sent to me. Brian, you playing anything besides Pizza Possum?
Yeah.
Anyway,
you have to think about that just as long as Jada had to think about if she ever wrote a segue.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll talk soon.
Yeah, okay.
Here.
I've decided, I don't know, I hit some point in Baldur's Gate 3 where I just was like, screw it, and I've become the worst.
Oh, I love it.
I just am like really being a really bad person. And like,
yes.
I did the equivalent of like blowing up Megaton, where like early on you basically have the option to like help a bunch of druids, or you can help a bunch of goblins kill a bunch of druids. And I was like, yeah, all right, I'll do that. And I just, I'm like having points where like stuff is I'm so bad at defusing situations that like my party members are literally killing each other. And I had to like save scum because like one of the girls I'm hanging out with tried to stab the other one in the neck. And I was just like standing there like, I was like not even trying. I was like, whatever. You guys do your thing. You guys can sort it out. And then it was like, and I was like, oh boy, I needed her to fight.
For our audio listeners, our Red has superimposed Max's head on the War of the World aliens now.
Really, just top of the line, great. Industrial Light and Magic on over here.
Become who you were meant to be, Max.
Yeah, so the thing that sucks about that, though, is that on the one hand, I did my weird little gnome man got to hook up with like the...
You're playing a gnome too?
Yeah.
Nice.
No.
Smurfs.
I look like a Funko Pop of Mark Zuckerberg. It's horrible.
Made my gnome blue.
I hooked up with the knight maiden Xanara or something. Like, she's the evil lady who you're supposed to kill.
Oh, Minthara.
I keep forgetting her name. If you decide to be bad, she is very attracted to you.
Oh yeah. And she sleeps with you basically instantly.
Right. Yeah. So that happens, and then she's like, anyway, loser, peace out. Come find me at these towers. And I'm like, oh, okay. And then immediately after if you do the bad thing and you kill all the druids, you're basically, you get like five, seven pop-ups that are just like, this quest updated. Yep. And it's like, you just fail all these quests. And it's like, I'm kind of like, well, I locked myself out of doing a whole bunch of stuff, but
it's the beauty of Baldur's Gate. That's the beauty of D&D. Yeah. It's like, you're going to play it multiple times. You're going to do different things each time, I would hope, at least, have different options and stuff. I did a genocide the other night in Baldur's Gate.
Whoa.
We we went down into the Underdark, and the little Myconids, the little mushroom people, asked us to go to stop the Dwergar, which are these like little dark gnome
bad gnomes.
Elves. people.
Gnome good. You know
yeah, no,
about.
Up to gnome good. And so we went and me and my partner.
I know what you're talking about.
We went and did it. We went and did a genocide of all of them in their camp. And then we went back to the Myconids, claimed all the rewards, and did another genocide on the Myconids. Okay. And so we did a double genocide.
Really? Just,
it was great.
Okay, you're being real bad over there.
I murdered a lot of people. We ended up reloading the save of murdering the Myconids, but...
okay.
But,
real mean.
It's great. It's great. I've built my character, my little gnome. Her name is Poppy. She's a fighter, and she fights like Thor. I basically have this ability where I have this like glowing hammer, and I throw it, and it magically comes back to me, and I get to throw it like four times a turn. So I'm just literally throwing my hammer at people.
Yeah,
it's great.
That's a very good game. I'm chipping away at it so slowly. I'll kind of be amazed if I finish it in time for Game of the Year conversations. But I think it's a pretty that game kind of ruins other games. I finished Phantom Liberty, which I liked, but it also like reminded me of a lot of stuff I liked about Cyberpunk and forgot about. It also reminded me about a bunch of stuff in Cyberpunk that annoyed me. We talked about that a little bit last time, but like I don't know. I'm glad I finished it. Brian, Akeem, is there anything you guys want to talk about? You want to plug real quick?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I know you asked everyone else what they're playing. I was playing around with my PSVR 2 just to make sure.
What?
Akeem,
you gotta just jump in with that, man.
It powers on. That I said I was just checking to make sure it still powers on. That's all.
Oh goodness! Yeah. So. Big update here.
They're gonna love you for that.
There is a big stack of PSVR games too that are recently announced and or coming out. I think it's
it's like Tiger Blade and a few others.
Looking forward to Among Us VR.
That does look pretty cool.
Pixel Rip 1995 is out today, and that's a game where you basically can simulate the thrill of playing video games in 1995 at your mom's house and arguing with other kids at Blockbuster about which is better, Genesis or Super Nintendo. They obviously can't use those names officially, but hey, if you need some virtual console wars, that's a place you can go do it. Jada, is anything you want to plug?
Yeah, we'll have a couple of other playlists and user reviews, things going live later this week. The big one is going to be the user reviews for Assassin's Creed. If you got a favorite Assassin's Creed game, check out the playlist that will get promoted on site, I believe Wednesday or Thursday with Mirage, whenever that embargo lifts. And leave a review for your favorite Assassin's games.
Nice. Akeem, anything you're working on?
No, I'm gonna be gone next week, just taking a much needed vacation.
Hell yeah.
So if you want to catch me, you can catch me on all the videos that we are producing this week, and of course you can check me out on my personal YouTube channel, geekheavy.com. Unfiltered Akeem. They filter me here on Beyond. We only get
geek
there.
Light here.
We filter you here.
No, it's lightly filtered. Trust me.
You brought a bubble gun on the show today. I don't really know what we're going to get.
There's a filter on it. Don't worry.
You bring fog machines and stuff on here. It's just, it's a lot.
The Foamstars is filtered. Otherwise, it would say something else that starts with an F and ends in stars.
A child's coffin with Sonic the Hedgehog in it on here. So I don't even want to do it.
That's true, yeah.
Know what you do at night.
Brian, anything you want to plug?
No, I'm working on some cool stuff right now, but it's still, you know, in production. In the meantime, catch me on NVC here and there. Jada and I were on the episode just the other day. It was a really good time.
Yeah, I had a blast.
She gave me a Super Mario Wonder keychain, which I
did.
Love.
You got
adorable.
An little elephant Mario.
Yeah. Nice. I just put up the big old video for this month's big game releases. It's like October's big game release. It's like the most generic SEO-friendly name for a video possible. Mm-hmm. It is not a generic or friendly video. It's actually, I try to be pretty friendly, but we put a ton of love and work into those every month. So please go check those out if you haven't. It's kind of just an entire sort of crash course rundown of everything getting released this month. And it is maybe the biggest release month of the biggest release year in recent history, possibly ever video game history. So that was a lot of work. It's like 17 minutes long or something. So
yeah, if you want to laugh at Max being probably his most hilarious self, just go watch that, because I really enjoyed it and laughed
it's a little more focused and corralled than it is here, but thank you all for bearing with me. I think we did it. The episode, we should probably just end the episode.
No, right? We could go longer. We can go longer, you know.
I think we're good. Hey everybody, thanks for listening, watching, and or hanging out with me on the show and beyond.
Beyond.